As you know, there are 7 speakers. That is Pak Dr. Ruanda Agung Sugardiman from the Ministry of Environment and Forestry. And then Bapak Kardiansa from the Ministry of Environment and Forestry. Dr. Dedi Nur Samsi from the Ministry of Agriculture. And then Dr. Haris Gunawan from the Peatland Restoration Agency, or BRG. And then Pak John Keefe from UN Environment. And then Pak Adam Geran from FAO. And the last one, Professor Harry Purnomo from CIFOR. Ladies and gentlemen, you know that peatland ecosystem play a crucial role as a water resources, reservoir and water regulation. And peatland have stored large stock of organic carbon under waterlogged and suitable climatic condition in anoxic condition. Human activities of peatland, such as drainage cutting down the vegetation, drainage construction, and shifting the land cover, result disturbances of peat ecosystem. Despite the ecosystem services that may provide by the peatland ecosystem, since long time ago, peatlands have supported human livelihood. Several flora species provide tangible benefit for wood, for food, latex, medicine, cultural values, and so on. And we have learned a lot of what we have done well and what we should have done differently. But we have tried a number of ways to utilization peatlands. Some have worked well and some have not. When we are going wrong, it costs us so much, be it environmentally, including health, be it economically, as well as socially. Ladies and gentlemen, before we proceed to the discussion, we will see so the short video about the peatland.
It damages the wealth heritage of Indonesia tropical forest and also degrades the biodiversity and the aesthetics inside. Forest fires cause serious threat to environment and economy. It damages the wealth heritage of Indonesia tropical forest and also degrades the biodiversity and the aesthetics inside. In 2015, the loss reached more than 221 billion rupiahs and wiped out up to 2.6 million hectare area. The causes are the land and forest fires in the peat ecosystem. President Joko Widodo emphasizes the importance of doing peat recovery.
Yang berkaitan dengan gambut, corrective action kita harus betul-betul berubah betul. Setelah moratorium gambut, masalah pelestarian gambut betul-betul lapangannya dilihat betul.
Ministry of Environment and Forestry had been executed seriously to inventory and map of peatland recovery in many regions since 2014. It divided Indonesia into 865 peat hydrological units, but the total area is 24.6 million hectares that is covered in 19 provinces. Total recovery that has been done in industrial plantation forest and oil palm plantation reached 1,200,000 209,086 hectares up to December 2017. This peatlands recovery effort has been doing by Ministry of Environment and Forestry, business practitioners and society altogether. Many commitments to recover peatland will be continuously doing by Indonesia. 111 corporates were agreed to construct around 3,755 units canal blocking. The construction was built for peatland rewetting by improving the water management in the working area. The peatlands rehabilitation will be done in the area of 28,101 hectare and by natural succession in 314,349 hectare. Ministry of Environment and Forestry engaged with the business practitioners. They have been compulsory to keep the height of the water on peatland not less than 0.4 meter above the surface so it would not be burned. Ministry of Environment and Forestry urges people to aware of the sustainability of peatland ecosystem through community self-movement. People around peatland area is proven to develop their village to make it better by partnership programs with many participants. The effort of peatland ecosystem recovery is actually can restore its functions as a source of biodiversity, water reserve, and greenhouse effect prevention. This effort will save the economic value and peatland ecosystem in Indonesia as the fourth largest country in the world. Presented by
tepuk tangan. Distinguished speakers and participants, this session is very interesting because after we seen the video, so the policy for restoration and sustainable management of peatland, I think is interesting to be discussed. And we have 7 speakers here. And after there is a presentation from the speaker, we will do the discussion with the participants. Every speaker will be allocated 10 minutes for presentation, highlighting the assigned topic, so you can use PowerPoint if necessary. For the first speaker, I would like to invite Mr. Karliansa, Director General of Pollution and Environmental Degradation Control in the Ministry of Environment and Forestry. Pak Karliansa, you know that Indonesia has over 15 million hectares of peatlands. Our peatland has a wide variety of peat ecosystem, including the coastal peat of the main island of Sumatra, Kalimantan, and Papua. And peatland also located in basin, for example, in Central Mahakam, East Kalimantan, Kapuas of West Kalimantan, as well Mamberamo River in Papua. Triggered by the impact of the massive fire, we know that almost more than 15 years indicated by the huge forest fire in 1997, 2013, and the most one is in 2015. And considering the condition of land and forest governance in general, President Jokowi has instructed to reinforce on suspension of permit issuance, new application in the primary forest and peatlands utilization, known as the moratorium. This is monumental decision reflecting the commitment of Indonesian government to reform its peatland and forest management. Certainly, we recognize the need for development, even as a pressure for such, we articulate by in-depth review for strategic national projects, such as infrastructure and energy. We know that a lot of policy have already issued. So my question, how to consolidate among stakeholders who are actively working for protection and management of peatland? The floor is yours, Pak.
Thank you, Pak Gus. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning. Honorable all speakers, Honorable Mr. Agus as a chairman for this session, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to extend my sincere appreciation to Australian government and Center for International Policy Research, who have collaboration with the Indonesian government to hosting the third Asia-Pacific Rainforest Summit will head in Yogyakarta, Indonesia. It is my great honor to have this opportunity to address this important meeting and share Indonesian experiences, management tools, approaches, and institutional framework in management of peatland. In this presentation, I will focus on the delivery of experience and best management practices in management and restoration of peat ecosystem, including in terms of improving the active participation of the private sector. Indonesia has the fourth largest world in the world, after Canada, Russia, and United States, and the largest of tropical peatland in the world. As the largest of tropical peatland, Indonesia has a lot of biodiversity. Tropical peatlands in Indonesia have enormous benefits for ecosystem, such as forestry, flood control, fire risk control, ecotourism, climate stability, biodiversity, the livelihoods of local communities, and also for education and research. That's why we need the same patience and priority to save peat ecosystem. As we know that the main problem in the peat ecosystem is uncontrolled drainage, which means that the water management system is not developed or poor water management. This is a serious problem that causes a peatland to dry up and land subsidence. The impact of both is occurrence of forest fire and land depression, leading to the release of greenhouse gas emission and plants. The history of legislation in the field of peat ecosystem management in the early 20th century focus more on agriculture cultivation by dividing the peat ecosystem based on the thickness of the peat. Peat with thickness more than 3 meters serve as protected area, while peat with less than 3 meters can be used as agriculture and plantation. We forget that the existing regulation govern more about the zoning of peat pits utilization, but none of the regulation government the media of its peat ecosystem. This means that through government regulation number 71 of 2014, amended by government regulation number 57 of 2016 concerning on peat ecosystem protection and management, more focus on regulating the characteristic and standard criteria for degraded peat ecosystem. The contents of government regulation number 71 of 2014 jump to government regulation number 57 of 2016 are divided into 5 sections, namely, first one is scope, cover planning, utilization, controlling, maintenance, supervision, and administrative sanction. The second one, determination of peat ecosystem function. The third, peat ecosystem protection and management plan. Fourth, the standard criteria for degraded peat ecosystem. And the fifth is restriction of the utilization of peat ecosystem. The derivative products of these laws are related to inventory of peat ecosystem characteristic and determination of peat ecosystem function. Water table measure. divided based on the forest area and non-forest area, as well as the concession or permit area therein. Liability of private sector based on Minister of Environment Forestry Regulation number 14-16 must carry out inventory and mapping of peat ecosystem characteristic covering certain parameters, measuring and reporting water table at compliance point on peatland, revise the business work plan, and set up the document of peat ecosystem restoration plan, and also apply for environmental permit changes and comply with the applicable laws and regulation. While for the government is to set up and declare a peat ecosystem function scale 1 to 50,000 based on inventory and mapping of peat ecosystem characteristic, develop the document of peat ecosystem protection and management plan at national, regional, and district level. Based on corporate performance rating program on peatland in December 2017, total of peatland ecosystem function covering oil palm and industrial forest plantation of 1,209,068 hectares. Hectares. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Pak Karliansa, for your very comprehensive presentation. Based on your presentation, we know that there is a comprehensive action and policy as well have been taken by the Indonesian government, including expressing political commitment, formulating a policy and regulation, and then establishing a special agency of peat restoration, and coordinating action with all level of governments and stakeholders. Policies, regulation, law enforcement, and institutional arrangement in improving management of Indonesian peatland have dramatically reduced the degradation of peatland and peat fire events. This also reflects a better governance of Indonesian peatlands that can ensure protection of good peatland areas from degradation and stop degraded peatland from further damage. I have a question, what is the lesson learned, policy and then experience on the management of peat ecosystem?
Thank you, Pak Agus. The lesson that we get from the evaluation during this time, that the solution to ensuring the conservation peatland is relatively simple. Keep them wet. So in the government regulation, the table water should be less than 0.4 meters. Or if they have been drained, revert them through application of peat restoration technique that include water management on set level, operation scale, construction, operation and maintenance work, including the arrangement of canopy blocking installation. I mean, rewetting infrastructure, and application of partition according to local wisdom and or research and development, taking into account and adding to the development of science and lesson learned from international perspective. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Pak Karliansa. Big applause for Pak Karliansa. I will to proceed to the next speakers. That is Dr. Ruanda Agung Sugardiman. Pak Ruanda, representing the Director General of Forest Planology and Environment Management, Ministry of Environment and Forestry. Pak Ruanda, you know that there is a policies regarding PPIP or indicative moratorium. So I would like to invite you to have presentation on this topic.
Thank you very much, Dr. Agus. Yes, this morning, very good morning, everybody. Yes, I'm from DG of Forestry Planning and Forest Governance. This morning, I will present what we have doing quite a lot, long time ago, long history, starting from 2011, about the suspending the new permit on primary natural primary forest and peatland area. So next, this is the long history of this presidential instruction. So it's the instruction from presidents only valid for 2 years, but fortunately it's extended several times. So now it's the fourth instruction for president, from president. So the instruction, this include the revision of the moratorium map every 6 months. So there is now, there is a revision number 13 that just launching in July. So the next revision will be in November. So next, berikutnya, Mbak. This is the how we create the moratorium map. This is contribution from 5 different ministerial. The first is as the coordinator is Ministry of Environment and Forestry, and also BIG, the Agency of Geographic Information, and the Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Agraria, and the Ministry of Home Affairs. So there are many input for make a map done with the revision. This has come from the result of the field survey, done by the Ministry of Agriculture, and also the revised from the special planning in the province or in the district level, and also from the land cover map. So the recent, we use the recent land cover map to update our moratorium map. So from different input, we create the new revision. So the next slide will explain how is the condition, the area that will be suspend for new permit in the next 6 or 1 year before the presidential instruction is expired. Hopefully this area is about 64 million hectares will be permanently, permanently suspend, so we can protect our primary, natural primary forest and our peatland area. This is the process that what we have done so far, Bagus. Yes.
Thank you, Pak Ruanda. We know that the current satellite technology and image interpretation and analysis as proportional skill is important and helpful for inventory analysis and planning. The social economy aspect as well, parallel to the landscape unit inventory, is the same important step. And Indonesia has gained extensive knowledge through these experiences. I would like to ask you how to consolidate the data, information, and policy among stakeholders to PPIP or indicative moratorium map, one map policy for peatland.
Thank you. Bagus. This is a good question for us, for Ministry of Environment and Forestry, especially DG of Forestry Planning. With this long history, so we come to what is, we call it a one map policy on peatland. So berikutnya mas, nyambung lagi tadi mas. So, one map is the presidential regulation number 9/2016. One of the thematic of the one map is the peatland. Berikutnya. Yes, during the one map policy, there are three main activity. The first is compilations. So in the all of the sector include in the one map should compile, should submit all of this map, and then we make a integration. And then the important activity is a synchronizations. Berikutnya. This is the organization how we deal with the one map policy. So the ministry coordinator of economic as a leader on this activity with several agency include on that activity. Next. And this one is the ministry that include in the one map activity, and we have 85 thematic layer that we compile from the every unit, every ministry to be compiled, to be integrated and synchronized. Berikutnya. This is how we ideally the spatial data can be accessed from the geoportal. Next. Yes. We in the one map we have a action plan. So first, as the presidential regulation, our first work is in Kalimantan in 2016, and 2017 Sumatra. We are working on one map, and this year we have to work on Sulawesi, Jawa, and Nusa Tenggara. And actually, next year, 2019, we have to finish Papua and Maluku. But fortunately, our president asked the working group to finish all of the Indonesia on this year. So we have to speed up the Papua and Maluku works this year also. So president won, we have to launch our one map on 18 August 2018. So we have a lot of work in this month. During this month, we have a lot of meeting, a lot of discussion to finish the target. Next. This is, what is the benefit of this one map? We can see from this one. There are many benefit that we can deal with the one map policy. So all of this benefit can also speed our sustainable development goal achievement. That's what we can explain, Pak Agus. Thank you.
Yeah, Pak Ruanda, we know that the implementation of indicative moratorium map and also one map policy should be have obstacles and also challenges. My question is, what is the lesson learned in the implementation of the indicative moratorium map and one map policy?
Thank you. There are big lessons that we can derive from the one map and the moratorium map. Previously, before this activity is done, we are very difficult to compile, to collect the data from every ministry, every sector. With the instruction of president and also the regulation of president, we forced to submit our own map to the national. So from that one, we can know who is doing what exactly. So now we can see only one map can be produced by one single institution. So there is no anymore double duplication redundancy a map that will be produced by another custodian or unit ministries. So now we have specific strong accuracy that specific layer, specific thematic must be done by specific ministry. So this is one of the challenges that how we can compile, how we can verify it, that who is doing what is a very supportive in this process. Thank you, Pak.
Thank you. Big applause for Pak Ruanda. I would like to proceed to the next speakers, Professor Dr. Dedi Nur Samsi. He's a director of Agricultural Land Resources Agency, Ministry of Agriculture. He will present about the restoration and sustainable peatland management on palm oil estate. So I would like to invite Dr. Dedi to give a presentation.
Thank you, Chairman. Terima kasih. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to discuss about restoration and sustainable peatland management on palm oil estate. Yeah. So, Indonesian peatland comprises about 15 million hectares, or 80% of the country's 190 million hectare total land area, mainly distributed in the coastal areas of Sumatra, Kalimantan, and Papua. Peatland is very important for environmental services, yeah, including water storage, yeah, carbon storage, and nice or peatland-specific biodiversity. Yeah. At the same time, peatland is also a very important land resource, yeah, for agricultural production, settlement, infrastructural development, and also mining. About half of peatland is still covered by forests. The land cover is important for environmental services. However, the feed forest is under pressure of conversion for various uses. About 1.7 million hectares of peatland is used for palm oil plantation. Other uses include rubber plantation and other agricultural uses such as paddy rice and vegetable farming. However, about 4 million hectares of peatland is being idle and covered by peat shrub. Yeah. So the peat shrub is source of CO2 emission, prone to fire during the long dry season, and also unproductive land. Peatland is very vulnerable environment. Under the next forest cover, it's relatively stable and built up solidly. When the peat forest is clear and drained, the change of anaerobic to aerobic condition escalates of CO2 emissions. Yeah. Emission also occur when peat is under fire. Palm oil is the most efficient and the most productive crops among oil production crops. Other competitors for biodiesel feedstock include rapeseed, peanut, sunflower, soybean, and corn oils. The productivity of those crops are only one-fifth or lower than that of palm oil. Palm oil is a perennial crop that can produce for about 25 years, while other crops produced in the temperate zones are mostly annual crops. Palm oil is among the most adaptable crop on peatland. I was mentioned already that 1.7 million hectares of the total of the about 12 million hectares of palm oil plantation in Indonesia is on peatland. Palm oil also is very efficient perennial crop that can start produce at the age of 3 years and continue the production until the age of 25 years. The oil yielding is 3 until 6 tons per hectare per year, which is equivalent to 5 to 10 times the yield of most other oil production crops. The harvest is every 2 weeks, which provides continuous flow of income. Soil management is rather unintensive, except for fertilization. It is also the highest national source of revenue. It's about US dollar 23 billion in 2007. From the perspective of yield, producers and smallholder farmers perceive that palm oil on peat is a sustainable production system, and it is so far a high production system. From environmental point of view, there are arguments that it is an unsustainable system due to the relatively high CO2 emission rate and relatively fast subsidence. Palm oil starts produced at 3 years after planting, and peak of production is about 7 years after planting, or the first year of harvest. Annual fresh fruit plants yield is about 25 tons per hectare, and this equivalent to about 5 tons of oil per year. This level of production will continue until the age of 20 until 25 years. The main degradation processes include subsidence, decomposition, and peat fire, which also cause a very rapid oxidation and subsidence, depending on peat dryness and water table. Factor affecting peat fire: when peat water content is less than 117%, fire can enter the peat layer. When peat water content is more than about 300%, fire only affects plant debris and dry vegetation. When the water table less than 70 centimeters from surface, unlike that, fire penetrates the peat layer. The risk of peat fire increases when water table is deeper than 70 centimeters. Yeah. Restoration approaches must comprise regulatory and management techniques. Regulatory measures that have been put in place include no use of fire, raising water table depth to reduce fire risk, subsidence, and emission. No new permit or moratorium for concession on peatland and natural forests. Technological innovation include wise use of fertilizer amelioran for increasing production, particularly on existing agriculture land. Intensification to maximize yield and thus reduce emission per unit mass of product, and no burning techniques. Previous studies show that ideal water table depths of 50 until 75 centimeters below surface for palm oil production. It seems that genetic studies should also be conducted to develop high water table adaptive varieties. The main management technique for peat and include water table regulation, fire control and no burning management, fertilization, amelioration using mineral soils and manures, etc. So I think that is all. Terima kasih.
Thank you, Professor Dedi Nur Samsi, for your comprehensive presentation. Yeah, I just want to highlight, as mentioned by Pak Karyansa, that the main principle in peatland management is to keep the peatland wet. Peatland gives your opportunities for development, including estate crops, with an appropriate treatment, particularly the hydrological function to keep the natural function of the peatland. As you mentioned in your presentation, I would like to ask you about how to consolidate information and policy among stakeholders who are actively working for restoration and sustainable peatland management, for example, on palm oil estate.
Thank you. So firstly, I would like to say that I strongly agree to Pak Dirjen said, that the main factor of peatland is how to make peatland wet. So that is why also in palm oil management, I think the most important thing is how to make water table near from surfaces, near from soil surface. So this is where now we have regulation from President Act, from President regulation that we have to maintain about 40 centimeters, from soil surface, But in previous study, I said mentioned already that at 50 and 75 centimeters, from soil surface, it's the highest production from oil palm. And also with our study, the CO2 emission, from that depth is about 40 until 46 ton per hectare per year. And also subsistence also is about 2 until 6 centimeter per year. So in palm oil management, in plantation management, I think the most thing is water table. We have to maintain in near soil surface. But plants still grow well. So that is why in last time I proposed to Kementerian Kehutanan that let's make about 60 centimeter. But we know already that now 40 centimeter according to President regulation. I think it is okay. And now, we are studying about, in relation to that, we are studying about what effects of 40 centimeter depth on CO2 emission, on subsidence, on also palm oil production, and also economic aspect from that. Now it's still going for that study. So maybe next year, we will release about that result to our colleagues here, particularly from BIRG and also from Kementerian LHK. Terima kasih, Pak.
Thank you very much, Pak Dedi Nur Samsi. Please big applause to Pak Dedi Nur Samsi. Distinguished speaker and participants, I would like to continue with the next speaker. That is Dr. Haris Gunawan. He's a Deputy Research and Development, Peat Restoration Agency or BRG. He will make a presentation regarding the utilization of peat ecosystem for community welfare to support peat restoration program. The floor is yours, Pak.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Pak Dr. Agus, for moderator. And I would like to say also very happy to be here. And then thank you for all of organizing committee to give BRG opportunities to introduce what the our mind about the community welfare. Before I continue the slide, I just make a clue. I think two months ago, there is no scientist say that if Indonesia can maintain 1 million hectare peatland and the peatland will be planted for the some commodity that. So after that, Indonesia can quite strong for the food security. And then I want to introduce one of the commodity that adaptive very wet peatland condition as Pak Kali and Pak Dedi say. You see that in the my slide presentation. This is sago, not oil palm, sago. It's quite similar. So. Thank you. So, I hope all of you, the participants, know start to understand and know about the sagu. Okay, I would like start my presentation title about the utilization of peat ecosystem for the community welfare. Next, as far as we have been through, peat ecosystem has undergone several degradation. This has been related to deforestation, fire, associating with the discourses economic development for human welfare, which might be misinterpreted. Therefore, it is essential that we reframe what is human welfare, because it is essential for sustaining peatland function, which is in turn will give benefit to human welfare itself. Next, utilization peat ecosystem to support restoration required a balance between healthy peat ecosystem and community welfare. It is because peat is fragile. When managed carelessly, it is easy destructed, and most of the time the destruction is irreversible. The destruction starts from the perspective to extract as much as ecosystem services from peat ecosystem. Whereas the term of community welfare shall not be considered as having as much as benefit from ecosystem or being greedy, gather acquiring benefit from peatland while maintaining the function of peat ecosystem. The declining of peat ecosystem is inevitable if it's not used wisely and adduce ecosystem. Next. Utilizing peat ecosystem means utilizing peat ecosystem services. This figure out the relationship of human and how they use the services for their well-being. This table shows us some ecosystem services and how it relates to the implementation of peat restoration. The first column is about the type ecosystem services, including provisioning what we can directly obtain from the ecosystem, regulating what ecosystem manages to regulate its natural function, cultural and supporting activities. Peatland are pronounced for its benefit in climate and water regulation. The second column shows us the strategy of peat restoration operationalized by the peat restoration agency and how the align with improving the peat ecosystem services. Beforehand, restoration strategy include 3 R, which is a revitalization of economy, revegetation and rewetting. We can say that utilization of peat ecosystem for community welfare can be started with the revitalization of local economy. Nevertheless, all 3 restoration strategies start with particular need of particular site. The third column shows the implementation of the strategy of restoration and ecosystem services. Some examples are given here, from adaptive local commodity for enhancing profitability ecosystem services, also to reforestation with indigenous species potentially profitable. But the market needs to be more developed, as well as complementary effort to rewetting such as fish production and ecotourism. Not to mention, restoration will improve the process of soil and water to regulate the aforementioned function. Next. This part shows us how ecosystem services can be used for the community welfare. First of all, we utilize the ecosystem services in scale of peat hydrology unit or kesatuan hidrologi gambut, meaning that peat ecosystem bordered with two river or with swamp or with the sea. Therefore, it is essential to acknowledge that utilizing peat ecosystem does not mean utilizing peat per se vice versa. This means that managing multi-layer strata of peatland. This table shows at the first column the management of peat ecosystem from floodplain area, alluvial area, toward inland shallow peatland and deep peatland, and the second column the product which is can be produced or enhanced for the community welfare. Next. This slide shows the mechanism of utilization peat ecosystem services. First, the peat restoration agency encouraged to utilize peat ecosystem by village-based priority. The graph shows that most villages in peatland are most village in peatland is categorized as desa sangat tertinggal and tertinggal. And under property line, this is rationally why the utilization of peat ecosystem shall be based on village. Second, accommodative for landscape approach of the village. Village entirely inside of peat hydrology unit 4, including in some hydrological unit. Next, I want to just escape this slide because about the social forest. Next. This slide shows how peat restoration agency is efforted to restore peatland in terms of revegetation, revegetation and revitalization of local economy. An example given for a site inside of peat hydrology unit. Revetting was done by building canal blocking, as in fact the area are revet, facilitating paludiculture for to be implemented. Next. Nevertheless, the scale of intervention aforementioned is rather small as pilot, and the measures still require further intervention to be improved, monitored, and upscaled. This table show as some aspect to be improved. Next. Next. The peat restoration agency is not alone on its work actually. Many parties have been working on the peat restoration access and particularly the utilization of peat ecosystem for community welfare. For instance, with Wetland International Indonesia program has been working on restoration on community base. ICRAF has developed the concept of agroforestry. Next. Next. So this is last slide that some people ask. This is can the restoration will be implemented or can be achieved? So yeah, based on this small plot, we can show that after the fire attack on the peatland, so we can use this land for the restoration. So mean that restoration can be done even in degradation in the degraded peatland. So the last one. Next. Conclusion. Peatland utilization for community welfare shall be done in balance with healthy peatland. The utilization shall be aligned with peatland restoration strategy, revetting, revegetation, and revitalization of local economy. The strategy has been in Indonesia and fruitful. The results will be given further intervention to enlarge, measure, monitor, and strengthen engagement with local community. Many parties work on the peat restoration in small scale pilot. Upscaling the pilot and working collaboratively is encouraged. Policy on biophysical aspect of peat restoration shall be coupled with policy on investment or social aspect of peatland. I think that's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Haris Gunawan, for your nice presentation. Pak Haris, as regards the history of utilization in the early 20th century, the utilization of Indonesian peatland was mostly for subsistence agriculture and conducted through relative sustainable practices. Subsequently, in the 1990s, the Indonesian government included peatland in the transmigration program and for logging concession. In 1990s, the government introduced industrial forest plantation and agriculture estate, in particular palm oil. The extensive promotion of this industry has degraded almost half Indonesian peatlands, which are mostly located in Sumatra and Kalimantan. In our record, not less than 4.5 million hectares of the private concession area since 1990 are peatland. How to consolidate data, information, and policy among stakeholders who are actively working for utilization of peat ecosystem for community welfare to support peat restoration program?
Yeah, thank you, Pak Dr. Agus. I think Indonesia already have regulation for guide all of us. The government regulation number 71 and then JOS 57 2016. I think all of the parties can refer this regulation, and then of course we need to improve the management of the peatland based on we call the hydrological peatland unit. So we know that based on the experience in the dome peat that has the function of the hydrology should be protected. If not, for the future and until now, we have a problem about the dry peatland. So I think we need to, of course, communicate and communication and dialogue about the achieve of the similar goal about the responsible and management. Sustainable management of peatland. And of course, I think also the research and idea for the breakthrough about how to make peatland better is very large opportunities and challenges. I think the research and development should be more strong for improving this goal, Pak. Thank you.
Yeah, it is interesting if we talking about the utilization of peat ecosystem for community welfare, yeah, especially to support the program. Indonesia has gained extensive experience in managing tropical peat, both in positive and negative terms, as managing peatlands to provide livelihood for local communities, as well as to conduct intensive agriculture and forestry may contradict with the protection of the environment. The option includes whether to drain water in the peatland for plantation development.
Like off-farm based management. So we have to edit the value not based on the off-farm, but for the economic activity not based on the on-farm, on the peatland. I think that's also not easy, but we have to introduce such kind of a concept, Agus.
Yeah, thank you. It's very interesting. We will discuss it later. Please give applause to Agus. Yes, for the next speaker, I would like to invite Johan Kif from UN Environment, or UNEP. He will make a presentation regarding the peatland sustainable management policy. The floor is yours.
Assalamualaikum. Salam sejahtera, Om Shanti Om, bagi semua tuan-tuan hadirin yang saya hormati. bilateral declaration between Indonesia and the countries of the Congo, with a global effort to start conserving and managing peatlands more sustainably, and use experience which has been already highlighted by the previous speakers in Indonesia for the global good of maintaining the carbon stored in the peat in the ground. And we talk in the Congo about the significant amount of carbon, about 30 gigatons, which if released in the ground, if released in the atmosphere, will make it impossible for us as humanity to meet the Paris Agreement.
It's a top of electricity. I think where we what do you continue about?
I got to do verbally.
Yeah.
And then I think you can obviously mention the mission of what I'm not presenting.
Yeah.
The global peatland initiative and why this global The global peatland initiative was established in 1950 and basically because of two main reasons. One, because there were the 2015 fires, peat fires in Indonesia, which made many in the climate community realize that the maintenance and restoration of global tropical peatlands are of critical importance to achieve the international agreed climate targets as outlined in the Paris Accord. And we must understand that peat fires are not a problem in Indonesia. Peat fires have been issues in 2015 in Russia and in Canada, when you talk about temperate and boreal peatlands. So, and then the other development was the discovery of huge peat deposits in basins in the previous peak unknown. These peat deposits were covering about 24 million hectares of land in both the Republic of Congo and in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and were containing over 30 gigatons of carbon. So, and if you look then at the spread of the tropical peatlands, as presented in the map, you can see now, okay, it's effectively a map of Africa, Southeast Asia, we can underline that both Indonesia as well as the Congo Basin play a critical importance in terms of where tropical peat deposits are, and thus are critical, the countries are critical to maintain and to ensure that the Paris Accord signing of the Basque Declaration in early March by the governments of Indonesia, governments of the Republic of the Congo, the governments of the Republic of Borno, which was the Indonesian signing by who doctor in Zibir, sitting by Waka, as Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Indonesia, and all the ministries of the fighting and the planning of the Republic of Congo and the Congo. And this underlined as well that
Thank you, Ivan. Thank you for the technical probe. Yeah, as you mentioned that there is a cooperation among the countries, especially on land management. Yeah, you mentioned also there is a cooperation, South and triangular cooperation. And I think considering its limited resources, it's a good idea if we, among the countries can share or collaborate with the international partners. And we do hope that through the support from the UN environment and also Global Peatland Initiative, we can provide an excellent platform for scientists, policy makers, and private sector to share experience and then lesson learned among the major tropical countries in the world. So I would like to know how to consolidate these resources, including knowledge, information among stakeholders, and then in the platform of South-South or triangular cooperation, and also what is the support of UN environment on this matter?
Thank you for the question. I think a very important start is now being taken by the Ministry of Environment and Forestry, is the establishment of an international tropical research institute. I think it is important that we start working together on joint research, of working and having research and scientists working together on solving the challenges of sustainable management and restoration, sustainable management of pristine peats, but also restoration of degraded peats in a comprehensive way. And I think that is a research center could play an important role in facilitating this South-South cooperation. And I think for us as UN Environment, I think it is a critical step forward, and we are fully supported in both in helping, assisting with the establishment, the setup, and the design, and also setting up the research agendas, and importantly, making research available for policymakers. Because ultimately, I think, as being shown by the previous speakers, it is important that the results of research are turned into action. And I think, in the recent years, I think we have seen significant progress here in Indonesia, where we have seen about 2 or 3 decades of research on peat. And we see, now, since the last couple of years, we have seen huge step forwards, and particularly in, for example, the enactment of government regulation 57-2016, Junto 71-2014, on sustainable management of peat, and which is actually must be fed by significant scientific insights on drainage depth, on land use planning, and so on, and zoning of peat management. And I think these are examples which we should look at better about learning and understanding, and then try to replicate these steps in other countries with significant extents of tropical peats. And this, of course, this is like the Congo Basin is one example, but I think here in this region, there are other examples, like the Mekong Delta is an example, the island of Papua is an example, as well as, you know, like in the sense, as well as a recent CIFOR research on the lines, as well as peatlands in the major deltas of South and Southeast Asia.
Thank you, Pak. Please give applause to Pak Johan Kip. Next, I would like to invite the next speaker, Mr. Adam Geren from FAO. He will present regarding with the experiences and policy for sustainable management of peatland. The floor is yours, Pak.
Thank you. Good morning, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, thank you for inviting me on behalf of FAO to participate in this event in Indonesia. My name is Adam Gerand, and I'd like to outline some of the work that we have done in FAO, but also many partners have been involved in this work, and I think even some of them are in the audience. So if I've neglected your name, please I apologize for that. But this is actually, FAO works to coordinate research and advice to countries, supporting countries with a range of partners. So I don't have time to thank them all here, but please, we do want to acknowledge them, the input. The organizers have kindly allowed me to have 5 minutes and 5 slides. So you can follow my remarks because I have some lists of points with some complicated steps, not so much detail, it's policy, so it's words, but I hope you can follow it on the slides. But I include some 8 bonus slides, and I hope they share the slides with you afterwards as well, because they have web links and references. So unfortunately, I don't have time to go into the details of the restoration, but my colleagues have already done that, and I've been asked to talk about what lessons learned on the policy experiences and the peatland management practices. So I want to start with it's useful, I thought, to go back to a document put together by the ASEAN, Peatlands Management Strategy for 2006 to 2020. This was done 12 years ago and probably started a couple of years before that. The first version was endorsed by ministers of 10 countries in 2006. So this is quite a long time ago that peatlands were recognized as an important issue. And I thought it was still useful to go back to it. It was revised again in 2013, and it's still, as far as I know, current. The strategy identifies a number of policy and institutional issues that I think we should look at again. For example, it talks about policy conflicts and weaknesses, the weak, unclear institutional arrangements, and the low capacity for peatland management. Inappropriate land use planning right at the start has resulted in a lot of the problems that we have with peatlands these days. Insufficient information on the extent, status, the land use, and how to manage these lands sustainably was clearly identified 12 years ago. And of course, insufficient understanding of peatland management. I'm actually pleased to say that while I put these up here again for us to think about, I'm pleased to say that we have made progress, particularly around the technical issues. The mapping and the extent and status of peatlands is rapidly improving, and I think Indonesia has done a great job on that. Recently, Johan mentioned the 24 million hectares of peatland has just been so-called discovered in Africa. It was always there, we just didn't know it, it was under the trees. So we are getting better at mapping the extent of peatlands. We are getting better at knowing how to manage them sustainably from the research done here in Indonesia by BRG and CIFOR and others. But, however, I think it's fair to say that many of the policy and institutional issues are still remaining, or they have only recently begun to be properly addressed. And they still have not been effectively resolved in many countries. I am really pleased to see that Indonesia is making progress on this with the presidential decrees and the work setting up the Peatlands Agency to focus on this topic. But I do think it's worthwhile that we continue to discuss this because we haven't resolved the institutional coordination and the policy issues effectively. Let me move on to some of the work that that FAO has been doing. When in countries that have large areas of peatlands, like Indonesia or the Congo, the peatlands' greenhouse gas emissions can form a major part of the national total. So we need to be including peatlands actively in the NDC and in your greenhouse gas reporting. And in response to that, FAO put together a report. I'm going to talk about 2 FAO reports. And if somebody wants a bonus copy, they can come and see me after. One of these was on greenhouse gas emissions from peatlands. And in particular, when you focus on a single topic and do work on that, you can come up with some fairly simple policy recommendations. This report listed 4 simple recommendations on it's a short list of the best peatland management strategies. We've heard them from our colleagues here, so I'm really pleased that these are being picked up and referred to by countries now as being their management practices. They're very simple. The 4 points are just conserve and protect intact peatlands. If you want to protect and reduce your greenhouse gas emissions, that's the first thing you should be looking at doing. Rewetting the drained peatlands is the next simple step. It's not so simple, actually, but it's a step. Applying climate-responsible peatlands management. And this is the practice that we've been hearing about from other colleagues, and we will hear, I'm sure, from Harry, about how to manage peatlands more sustainably, but still provide some livelihood options for people. I think we need to also recognize that some places the rewetting of peatlands is not possible, and those lands will continue to have drainage, and they will probably continue to have emissions from that. We need to look at the best ways to manage those lands where rewetting is not possible. In those four steps, I think Indonesia is already addressing and those challenges. In the last few years, it's been a dramatic change in policy and a really encouraging sign. Many other countries have yet to take these steps. So I think, as Johan said, there's a lot to be said for sharing experiences on this. Let me look at the next issue, though. If we move on from thinking about peatlands just solely with a focus of climate change, if we look at managing peatlands for a wider range of issues and values, because it's unlikely to be driven by just one objective of climate change. Every country with large areas of peatland is going to have a lot of objectives for their land. So FAO has been working with other countries and with partners to learn how to better manage peatlands for a range of objectives. And in the 2012 report that we put together from the MECA project, which I also have a copy of here, when you have more issues, you have more policy guidelines. This report had 10 recommendations, and I'll just briefly go through them here. Of course, we still need to identify the peat status. We need to improve the assessment of the greenhouse gas, which is still not very well known. We need to do a better job on that. Conserving the management of peatlands, conserving the reasonably intact peatlands, preventing degradation and restoring them, these management practices and principles are still there. But in addition to this, when you are looking at managing peatlands for multiple objectives, you need to start to think about financing. You need to target that financing to improve the peatland management. And actually, we have some good options now. We have REDD Plus as being a potential funding source to get money in the international arena to help manage peatlands because of their high carbon stores, and the reducing emissions is quite possible in peatlands. We also have national adaptation and mitigation actions. They can be applied in policies in government to help address peatlands issues. I'd really like to highlight and underline this issue of supporting local communities. It's great to hear it mentioned already by other people, because this is a very important issue. In large areas of peatlands, you have local people living there. They are going to make their livelihoods. They need some alternative livelihood strategy, because otherwise they will continue to do the practices that they used to do. If they don't know any better, or if they are not encouraged or given some incentive to change their practices. This is very important. We also have to address the issue of sometimes perverse or unwanted outcomes, where we have subsidies on commodities, for example, that might be resulting in undesirable land management outcomes. We need to look at those and address those. If there are issues around changing land use practices, some incentives could be applied, or you could put certification to take into account the greenhouse gas emissions that are coming from those products if they're grown on peatlands, compared to growing them on mineral soils, where you may have the same product produced but a much lower greenhouse gas outcome. So those issues there. And I think, as Johan mentioned, sharing countries' experiences and expertise, especially for capacity building among countries, within countries and then across countries, to learn from each other is very important. My next and final slide is really on some conclusions. I've talked about climate policies, but climate policies alone are not sufficient if other policies are working in opposition to what you're trying to do with your climate objectives. You need to have a harmonized approach across the different sectors to get the real outcomes you want. This is complicated, where you have different ministries responsible, but it's a major need. We also need to be supporting communities, as I said. with sustainable livelihood options on peatlands. Polluticulture, that is using peatlands in a less intensive, more sustainable way while they are wet and keeping them wet, is really important, but also enabling the communities to produce food and to do a livelihood, maybe some income generation. We were talking about non-wood forest products, fish ponds, all those things. I was really pleased to hear about ducks. I think ducks could be a good idea. I've heard about that. Maybe not in the same pond with the fish, but I don't know. It's a really interesting idea. And I think we still need to address this major challenge of institutional coordination and capacity. That is still a major need in almost every country. Indonesia is not unique. You have many institutions here. Some countries are not so big or complicated as Indonesia, but it's still an issue in almost every country, and lessons learned from that are really useful. So I actually was a little provocative, and I hope you don't mind if I provoke you and start to think about an outcome from this workshop or this conference by suggesting a possible recommendation. It's a little bit too wordy because I'm a research kind of person, not a policymaker. Too many words. But I was suggesting that perhaps we should be thinking that peatland policies should be evidence-based, they should include land suitability, societal cost benefits, and they should be supported by harmonized socioeconomic policies through coordinated institutions. I heard from many of our speakers that Indonesia is grappling with this and making good progress. I wish you well with that those efforts, and I hope you've got some very good results to share with other countries. So in closing, I'd like to finish by saying there are many, many promising approaches and measures being taken by some countries, and I'm pleased to really congratulate Indonesia for the work being done by the Peatlands Restore Agency, by the Ministry of Forestry and Agriculture on improving land management on peatlands. I'm really pleased with that, and I hope we can apply those good approaches, scale them up, and also transfer them to other countries. This will require political will, it will require funding, it will require capacity development. It never goes away, capacity development. It's a continual challenge to always improve. So don't think you can do capacity development once and then stop. It's an ongoing process. FAO is already working with most countries in the region, and we stand ready to support countries continuing to expand the work on this. I think there's really good work being done in Indonesia, and Johan has outlined how that's been exchanged with Africa. And finally, I look forward to the discussions and the constructive results and hopefully some positive outcomes from this Asia-Pacific Rainforest Summit. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Adam, for very informative presentations. Yeah, as you know that many countries has experiences on developing policies for managing peatland properly. Some policies considering the negative impacts of unsustainable use of peatland is actually an important lesson for other countries with similar situations. This will be so much relevant to other countries as well. My question is, what lesson learned and policy experience on the sustainable peatland management practices among the countries?
Sorry, could you just repeat?
Yeah.
It's a bit echoey.
What is lesson learned and policy experience on the sustainable peatland management practices among the countries, as you mentioned?
I think the policy and policy experiences are relatively immature for sustainable management of peatlands globally. I think many countries are struggling with this. There are very few countries, even in Europe. I think most of the scientists working in Europe would say that much of the peatland that is managed for agricultural production historically has not been sustainable. The peatlands, even in the Netherlands, they are going down. They are being degraded and slowly subsiding. This is an issue not just of developing countries. It's a major challenge for many countries. However, there are some promising signs, and I think the work being done here in Indonesia is equal up there with the world. The Scandinavian countries recognized a long time ago that draining their peatlands was not going to sort of be a sustainable solution. They actually have a lot of forestry on peatlands, and they do low intensity forestry, much lower intensity, because of their recognition that they need to manage them more sustainably. I think these lessons are still evolving, and really sharing experiences about countries. There are very few success stories, but when we get them, and I hope Indonesia is going to be one of those, and that you continue to promote that approach and continue to share your results, because many other countries are at the early stages of working out how to manage their peatlands. Africa, certainly, when they came to the Global Peatlands Initiative meeting last year here in Indonesia, in Jakarta, they were very pleased to learn from the Indonesian experience, and it was excellent that the minister herself, Minister Siti, went to the Congo recently with a big delegation from Indonesia and started to share that experience. Most countries are still relatively at the early stage. Europe should have learned how to do it now by a long time, but they still have got problems. And I think Latin America is also still at the stages. They mostly have alpine peat, but some in the forest areas. They also have lessons to learn as well. So it's at the early stages, I think, in most countries. Thanks.
Thank you, Adam. Please give applause to Adam Jeran. For the next speaker, I would like to invite Professor Dr. Harry Purnomo from CIFOR. He will present about the social characteristic of communities around peatlands in support of sustainable management of peat ecosystem. The floor is yours, Pak.
Okay, thank you, Pak Agus. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, everyone. I'm Harry Purnomo, scientist at CIFOR, as well as a professor at the Bogor Agricultural University. Next, please. I have four key messages that I would like to deliver in this opportunity. First, around the political and economical interests of actors. It's very, very important to understand the interests of actors, the large corporation, the elite, the government, the international community. Those actors influence provide effect to the fire prevention as well as the peatland restoration. Need to understand they have a power and sometimes they have a money to influence. The second one is, I can be quite provocative also, as well as you, Gerard. Yesterday, the ambassador of Norway mentioned that agriculture around the globe is a driver of a deforestation, including, of course, soybean in Brazil, as well as oil palm in Indonesia. And the third one is around the land use contestation on the ground, the dynamic on the ground. Who own the land on the ground at the village level? There's a lot of illegal land transaction there that influence the fire, influence the peatland restoration. We need to understand that on the ground. What happened there? Who are the actors? Who are the communities there? Otherwise, we just talking paper and paper. We need to understand the power dynamics on the ground. And the last one, I'm going to share the business model. What we need to have a community-based business model to ensure fire is prevented and peatland is restored. Business model. And who is going to invest on the ground? So I'm going one by one. Next, please. Wow. This is a fire in 2015. I took with my own camera. So in Bengkalis, we had a Pak Haris. Destroy the land as well as forest. And yeah, we do our best not to allow this kind of fire happens again in the future. Next, please. This is the politics. You see the five ministers last December Ibu Puan Maharani, Pak Wiranto, Pak Darmin Nasution, Ibu Siti Nurbaya, as well as Menteri Pertanian, the Minister of Agriculture, Pak Amran, to talk about preventing fire, launching the grand strategy to prevent fire. So it's very, to me, the government is committed, seems, at least the minister, the five minister, came together to the launching of grand strategy. As well as I look at the commitment of the private sectors, we know that the APP have a DMPA, April have the Fire Free Village program, and others, the oil palm companies, they have a kind of commitment, but need to prove on the ground. And smallholders, we need to also to understand the smallholders, who really they are. Because in my CIFOR study, there is a good phenomena to understand that we talk about oil palm. If we understand the smallholder oil palm, that the indigenous community mostly have a very small oil palm, and the APL in non-land and non-forest zone, non-forest area. These are the indigenous people, less than 2 hectares. But those who have more than 10 hectares in the forest area, actually is not the mostly not the indigenous people, but more the migrant coming from other provinces. They need to understand to the constellation on the ground, who actually the smallholder. Also, next please. Oh, this is landscape transition. I just stop here. We need to understand this to understand how the landscape around the globe transform from forest to agriculture. It is true in Indonesia, it is true in Brazil. Yeah. So how to be wise with this figure, yeah. Transforming from the rich forest to agriculture, and sometimes through fire. Next, please. Again, this is the figure of the, actually it is a protected forest, yeah. In Rio, Pak Haris. So this is, I took with my own camera there, yeah, when the bulldozer actually bulldozing the protected forest and planted again oil palm. This is the, we did a commitment actually from the government, from the Ministry of Environment, Ministry of Agriculture. And also, I need to draw attention to the role of elites at the local level. There are many, many local elites. Yeah. I just came back from Rio, actually, just 4 days ago, and they offered me get land to sell. Yeah. Are you interested to buy land here? Land with oil palm for 4 hectares, 100 million hectares with the oil palm. And also land without oil palm. This is, to me, land transaction on the ground. Next, Pak. The second one is, are we talking about the soybean and oil palm as driver of a deforestation? It is true in Indonesia, Pak. You see in the there how much money I stand up to generate from oil palm. We export now is $23 billion. It's almost twice than all the export coming from wood, but including pulp and paper, furniture, construction. But in the expand of the deforestation here. So see, there are from the study of Gunarso, I quoted, where the land coming from, first coming from the primary forest and secondary forest. The second one is from shrubs, and the last one is from other conversion, including a bare land and agriculture land. So you see this, there are some oil palm is good, yeah, there's nothing wrong with them. Do not convert at all the forest area, but some actually coming from primary forest as well as the secondary forest. So we need to work how to resolve this. This is a simulation, business as usual, but I have a lot of policy recommendation but to overcome this, to make sure that the oil palm can go together with the forest conservation. This the, to me, like the overall goal, yeah? The landscape approach, how the agriculture development come hand in hand with the forest conservation. And see, this is the emission of CO2 to the atmosphere. And why the coming flat? Because according to several study, the maximum land for oil palm Indonesia suitable is around 44 million hectare in Indonesia. We need to check again, but this is the publication I have. So again, oil palm is alleviating poverty. 21% of oil palm is on peatland. Oil palm is alleviating poverty, generating a lot of income to the government, to the people, but we need to, again, how to reduce the case of deforestation. It's managing trade-off, landscape approach, and I disagree with EU boycott, but it's not good. So boycotting the commodity is totally bad. There are some good practices of oil palm and also bad practices. The good practices need to allow to enter to the whole world market. But the bad practices, we need to improve that. That's why we have ISPO, Serang Tedang ISPO, RSPO, and ICC. This is the again the contestation, land use contestation. There's a lot of elite working on the ground to convert the forest, the peatland to agriculture commodity, rubber, to oil palm, to pineapple and others. It's to sweet corn and others. So it's, again, there is a indigenous people, there are migrants, as well as a lot of illegal land transaction. That's why I concern with the low budget of the Ministry of Environment and Forestry. It's not much, but you only have through 7 trillion, 426 million hectares. It's small. You need to ask more money to the President Jokowi. But otherwise, you cannot secure your territory. And we need to speed up. I agree with Pak Ruanda, the one bed policy, Pak, moratorium. The solution will be social forestry. We need to speed up social forestry. And also agrarian reform. Yeah. Agrarian reform. If it is oil palm, is already oil palm, it cannot be converted back to the forest and owned by indigenous people, just let it go. Just be the oil palm. Because now we are in the situation that's lose-lose. Right? The government lose because they cannot get a tax from the oil palm, particularly the smallholder. And the smallholder also in the lose situation because they oftenly not to do a good practices of oil palm because they are not certain whether the government will take away the land. So they don't use a good seedlings, they don't do a good fertilizers. Yeah. They don't maintain a lot. That's why the productivity is around 10 ton per hectare, much less than the ideal productivity of a oil palm. Next, please. This is a picture that I took 4 days ago. People still using fire. Yeah. 4 days ago, Pak Raffles still using fire. But I congratulate a lot to the Pak Raffles team because Indonesia has reduced fire from 2016, 460,000 hectare to 160,000 hectare with more or less the same weather situation, the same precipitation. It means that it did not depend on the weather, but depend on the the effort of all parties, including government. But some still using fire to fertilize the land. That's why, next please. It is very important to develop the business model for community. Who is going to invest, actually? It's a lot of investment. But, if you use fire, then only 20 hectare, $20 yeah, per hectare. But if you don't use fire, you need $500 or even more than that. Yeah. So we need to understand that. Again, business model is about the organizational design and value creation. How to create value from the peatland. On farm, off farm, Paris mentioned rubber, jelutung, pineapple, dragon fruit, yeah, fish, sagu, and agroforestry. Off farm also very, very important. It's jagung, yeah, but it's not for the wetter pit. Yeah. But jagung and pelelawan is quite good, the industry, small scale industry. And again, the government need to invest, the corporation, we need to ally with a large corporation to invest on the community-based pit restoration. Otherwise, whose money? Yeah? And also, I don't know, from CPO fund, yeah, can they invest their money to pit restoration? And from individual. Next, please. Again, my message, there are four. First is understanding the political economy, the interest of people in Jakarta, as well as in provincial, as well as in New York and Paris. Yeah. And the second one is understanding the agriculture, that we need agriculture, but we need agriculture. I mentioned that forest need a oil palm need forest. Oil palm without forest will be disappear, gone. But no water, no pollination, no food, other food. But the forest need oil palm, yeah, for sending people, their kid to school, yeah, for creating job. They need oil palm, how to work together. Yeah. And the third one is a contestation on the ground. The mostly illegal, who's going to go there to control the contestation? It's uncontrolled. Yeah. If you go there, just they can offer you land. Yeah. And the last one is a business model, yeah, the organizational design and value creation for his free, sustainable livelihood need to invest and exist. Yeah. Need to exist. Yeah. Access is important for a role model. That's why with Pak Haris, we work together, try to have a case on the ground for a community-based peatland restoration. Thank you, Pak Agus. That's all my presentation.
Yeah. Thank you, Pak Heri, for sharing four key messages. Yes, we know that promoting traditional practices is a part of restoration of peatland. And coherently to reduce to reduce deforestation and peat degradation while promoting social forestry program is promoted is a part of the effort of on peatland management under participatory villages. Yeah, you know that forest and peatlands is important element of NDCs in Indonesia. It covers 17% out of 29% of emission reduction up to 2030 in business as usual basis. I would like to know how are the methodological improvement in the greenhouse gases emission.
Wow, this is a good question. We've been as far I've been working for 5 years to develop the methodological things to measure the emission, but to me, like developing methodology is one thing, but measuring is another thing. And what we need, Pak Agus, rather than continue debating on methodology, show me a case, a number, yeah. Whether are we going better today compared to last year, yeah, in terms of total emission in Indonesia? Are we going to be better or worse? Yeah? So what we need from the people actually the scoreboard. Yeah? I know the SBY, the President Yudhoyono, you know, in 2009 actually made a commitment. Already 9 years, but seems public doesn't really know. Are we successful to reduce the emission? Regardless so many methodological issue, but to me like implementing it, measuring it, the carbon emission, and showing to the public. So are we better today compared to 9 years ago, or are we going to be even worse today? That's provide the spirit of people. That's one thing. The second thing is buyer commitment. Yeah. The red, the carbon credit buyer commitment. I read the ecosystem marketplace that more than 90% of red plus credit around the globe, no buyers, but nobody buy the carbon credit. Yeah. So again, to me, like we have been debating 5 years to talk about the methodology. But we need to move forward by showing to the public that we have reduced or we haven't reduced. The third one is a buyer commitment. That's why I challenge the GAPKI, can you buy carbon credit? Yeah. Because a lot in Indonesia is producing carbon credit. And to me, carbon credit is buyer driven. If buyers there, producer will exist. Yeah. If there is no buyer, there will be no producer. So again, I know that the red plus reducing carbon is now becoming policy, but originally it is a market instrument. But again, we are, Pak Gerard, Pak Johan Kif, at the international level actually is not very successful to create a strong buyers. Strong, real buyer, real money, ya, Pak, money. When the Norway committed $1 billion, take that money, put it at the third party. So make sure that money is there. Because to be at this buyer, if the buyer exists, then the producer will produce carbon credit, will conserve. Yeah. So in other words, economic money matters to the conservation. Thank you.
Thank you. Please give applause to Pak Heri Purnomo. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to invite comments, questions, and also inputs from the audience. Please notify yourself. One, two, three. Yeah, silakan Pak.
Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning. I'm Cut Johan from Universitas Gajah Mada. I think all presenters give very interesting talk. But I have a question about the water depth in the peatland. You said, I think Bapak Dedi said that 50 centimeter water depth for the palm oil. What does it mean? It means will be 50 centimeters, the peat will dry. So CO2 will increase. Okay. So I'm agree that we have to keep the peat land is wet. That's very important. Hydrological unit in wetland is very important. The heart of the sustainable wetland depend on the hydrological unit. I have also a question about the sago. I think sago is important. Yeah, it's also can be food staple. But sagu, I think they need special pH. So the pit water in the wetland is the pH around below 4. It's sometimes is acid water. So do you think the sagu can grow, will produce very good and healthy sagu? So I also agree that surrounding of the wetland, there is people very poor. So how many they are? We have 7 million hectare palm oil. So why we always say that the property around the wetland, the peatland, but how many, how wide we already changed this tropical peatland and tropical rainforest become the palm oil. I agree that we have to have, you know, income from the palm oil, but we lost a lot of the tropical biodiversity. So peatland is important for tropical rainforest because there is always big peatland, tropical peatland next to the tropical rainforest. So I agree that we have to increase the property. But how many people and how wide? I think enough is enough. I agree that with the moratorium. So the moratorium, if I don't mistake, it's for the primary forest. So where is our primary forest? All the forest is log over forest. So I don't understand that why. So I agree. Why we didn't plant it natural peatland tree with high economic value, such as jelutong, ramin, I think there is like 4 others. But it takes time, 5 years from the natural tree to grow. We harvest with sustainable harvest. We use wisely, we protect, and we sustain. But it needs time, 5 years, that seedling of those trees can grow. So it means why we didn't create job for this property, for these, you know, poor people for 5 years before we harvest with sustainable harvest. I think it's very simple. Government have to, you know, to create job for these poor people for 5 years, and then they will harvest. And it's very expensive wood. Ramin is equal to thick wood. So I think that my opinion. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah. Next, Pak Faisal.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I have three.
Please identify yourself.
Faisal Parish, Global Environment Center from Malaysia. I have three questions. Pak Kalyansha, you described about the process with the rehabilitation and very good progress made with the private sector, but for the community, relatively a slow progress, directed by the ministry. So in your view, how do we scale up effectively the support to the local community and how to finance it? Secondly, Pak Rwanda, you gave some information and update on the one map. Can you just clarify now with the new concept of peatland hydrological units, is that also included in the framework of the one map? And also with the new regulation and the SK 129 and 130, which are looking at the conservation zone, are those also integrated into the maps? And finally on that, I understand recently there was an Indonesia Peat Prize which came up with a new methodology for the peatland mapping. And moving forward, you said there is another 1 year to finish off the mapping on the one map. Will that new methodology be used in that period to finalize or update the peatland area? Third question to Pak Dedi. You mentioned that there has been a study on the benefit and impacts of the higher water table in the oil palm areas. You said the full result will be next year, but are there any interim result you can share on that? And secondly, I personally am involved working with the RSPO, which has in 2012 developed a manual on best management practices for peatland, oil palm cultivation on peatland and restoration and management of forests associated with oil palm cultivation. We're in the process of updating that manual, and I think that the very good and experience from Indonesia in the last 5 years would be extremely useful. So how can RSPO better engage or work with the relevant ministries in Indonesia to seek the input and the good practice information for the updating of the RSPO manual? Thank you.
Thank you. One more, Pak.
Thank you.
Pak Gusti.
Thank you. My name is Gusti Ansari from Tanjungpura University in West Kalimantan, Pontianak, and also serve as a panel expert for BRG, Badan Restorasi Gambut, with Pak Haris. Thank you very much. Pak Haris Pranomo clearly illustrated that this is a market-driven to make land uses, right? So from local people until the top. So also here, we're looking at why like this, because, you know, maybe people need to have a pretty clear, good market, like oil palm. That's why they would like to plant oil palm or follow the path, just from global until the finished level. Of course, we have so many options to develop commodities on peatland, but it's not that simple, right? So we need to develop a good market system for this. And this is the problem, I think. In Indonesia, for example, we have a very strong peatland policy, but we still maybe lacking option how to develop our peatlands. And then we are so we are poor also in collaborating or collaborative management. And then the last one, maybe we are still poor how to control our peatland after we make the after we allocate the uses of peatland, and then we are maybe neglected after all. So there are 3 points. We need a good option, and we need good collaborating, and then we need to have a good control. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you, Pak Gusti Ansari. So I would like to invite the speakers to respond the question and also give a closing statement. Let's start from Pak Ruanda.
Thank you. There are 2 questions as related with my presentation. The first from Ibu from UGM. Berapa banyak, how much the primary forest less in Indonesia? So now, Bu, we have 126 forest area, and from that, 90 million is a forest covered, and 40 million hectare is a primary forest. So the secondary forest is about 45 million hectare. So we still have many primary forests. From 40 million hectares, 9 million hectare is within in the moratorium map, so will not be converted to others cover. So we make sure with this presidential instruction, 9 million hectare will be stay in primary peatland area. The second question from Pak Paris, Malaysia, about the one map for peatland. So peatland map is responsible for Ministry of Agriculture. So the custodian is Ministry of Agriculture, who made the updating of the peatland map is Ministry of Agriculture. So the regulation from Ministry of Environment and Forestry to update this map is depend on the updating of the peatland from the Ministry of Agriculture. And you asking about the peat price methodology. So the guys who win the prize in behind you, Pak Solihin. So the methodology will be adopted by BIG to make a national standard, Indonesian national standard of peatland mapping. So all of the five winner will be accommodated to become national standards. So now BIG is working on the developing the national standard. So hopefully within 1 year the standard will be finished. So for the updating the peatland mapping is unfortunately we cannot finish in this year. So maybe after we have a national standard, we can make a good map of a peatland in Indonesia. That's what I can answer your questions.
Thank you, Pak Ronanda. Next, Pak Kardiansa.
Thank you, Pak Agus. Thank you, Pak Faris. Talking about the response of local communities. As I have mentioned before, we get a very positive response from the business sector. Until now, we got about more than 120 restoration plan document that submitted by them, and we have already approved 88 companies. The problem that we have faced is from local communities, but based on the President Regulation Number 1 of 2016 concerning peat authority, peat restoration authority, BRG, the responsible for enhance local community in the 7 provinces in BRG. So that we have, or we just responsible for the outside of 7 province. Let's say Aceh, West Sumatra, Sulawesi, something like that. So I think Pak Haris can keep real data from the local communities. Thank you.
Terima kasih. Firstly, Ibu dari UGM, about water depths 50 until 70 centimeter. So in our previous study that it was very ideal for palm oil growth. So because the maximum yield in that deep, yeah. But it did not mean that from 50 centimeters to soil surface, yeah, was dry. Not meaning that, yeah, because our teacher, yeah, Pak Professor Azwar Mas, say that we have to maintain capillary, water capillary. Yeah, so although, yeah, water deep about 50 until 70 centimeter, it still help. Water capillary is not problem because soil surface is still lembab, is still wet. Yeah, and the risk of fire also is very low if, yeah, we have water content in that soil so high. Yeah. Jadi demikian, Bu. And the second one about wet condition. So I said again that I strongly agree to Pak Dirjen, ya, Pak Karliansa. Yeah. We have to maintain peat soil in wet condition. But of course, from agriculture, we have to propose not only wet condition, but plant still grow well. That's key point. So that is why we have to consider that both aspect, plant growth and water depth. And about sago, of course, is also we strongly agree. Pak Haris mentioned already that sago is the best one for peatland area, because that plant is very tolerant to water condition, to fluid condition, and also tolerant to pH, to low pH. But also we have to consider that in our study, we had compared between some communities of economical aspect of some communities, include sago, palm oil, celutung. And our study indicated that palm oil is still the highest one in economical aspect. So that is why many population, many company still grow palm oil because high economical aspect compared to other commodities. But I discussed already with Pak Haris also that we have also consider the downstream of sago. The quality of sago is very good compared to paddy in terms of gizi. But in post-harvest aspect, it's still limited. So the value added of economical aspects in the post-harvest is very high. So we have to consider innovation technology for post-harvest of sago. If population or company had a lot of money from that sago, I think all of population or of company will select sago, not palm oil. And the other thing about in our study also in our group, we concluded that sago is tolerant to flooded and also tolerant to acid soil. So I think no problem. Acid until 4.0 is still okay for sago because sago is very adaptive. In lowland area. And then Paris, from Malaysia, the progress of our study. So now, of course, we still collecting data, Pak. Still collecting data. So we selected some location for our research. And also we have collaboration research with some palm oil company like Astra, Aglo Lestari, and also Smart. So we selected our research, our location in their location. And then of course, we did consider also peatland depth. So we have to put our measurement in each of depth, from shallow until deep peat soil. So, and then also, we set up some tools, like hobo, for monitoring soil level, and also we set up AWS, automatic weather station in that area to collect climate data. Of course, periodically, we measure also greenhouse gases emission from that. So maybe in every 6 months, we have to collect also yield production from that company. So I think next year, Pak, yeah, next year, Paris, we will can discuss about it more deeply. About RSPO, so my colleagues, yeah, from Ministry of Agriculture, of course, yeah, still in process to update our RSPO manual. So I'm sorry, I'm not sure about that progress, because my colleagues, yeah, is doing that manual. So, saya kira itu, Pak. Terima kasih.
Next, Pak Haris.
Thank you, Pak Agus. Bapak Ibu, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to, before I make a response about Professor Johan, I would like to also introduce that Professor Johan, he is my lecturer when I took the undergraduate in Gajah Mada. I want to ask you to give applause for her. Thank you, Bu Ucut. I think if we talk about the peat swamp ecosystem, the basic concept should be understanding that how do we minimize the intervention to this ecosystem. So because we already have 20 years, two decades of the experience, if we push this ecosystem, so the after that we will invite the disaster, especially haze. I think this is the start point for all of us to move to the new direction about this ecosystem, especially to understanding. I got the study from the Gajah Mada University also. I'm not make afraid about this, but based on this study, during 20 years, the rainfall right now getting decreasing because the perhaps for the climate change. As we know that peatland ecosystem consists of almost 90% of water. So if the climate change continue, so we just to rely on this ecosystem for the tropical rainforest or tropical region. So why we have to understanding about the ecosystem services for this ecosystem for now and the future. That's the one concept that we would like to make deal. If we honestly love for this ecosystem. And the second, I want to clarify about the sago. When they form our study, the sago we can clarify three types. One, if we can reach optimum productivity, of course, they should be planted or should be grow on the ecotone zone, fresh water and then seawater. And the peat, just shallow peat. The people, the community people, we call the gambut manis, as like that. Sweet peat. Shallow, very shallow peat. The productivity we can push to get good. And the second, the type of the sago, we can say that moderate productivity. So they just middle of the peat depth and then still also get the like pasang surut area. And the very low, in the very deep peat, we call the low productivity, but sago still grow. And then for the future should be understanding and should be promote to the mixed crop
with the other local species of the peat swamp forest, so they can grow together. So that's the ideal of the sago. I agree that Professor Johan said that creating job for the community is very also interesting. And how many community right now poor? I think so also should be discussed further about the criteria of the property of the poor people on the community. Because if we go to the local community, they are happy live on the natural peat swamp. But if we move to the other village, that the village from the outsider, they say, no, I should be use this peatland. Something like that. So we need to further discussion about that. I think that's all, Pak Agus. Thank you, Pak.
Next, Pak Johan.
Okay.
Closing statement.
Terima kasih, Pak Agus. Kijk, I would like to stress one thing. I think this is important to understand. We talk about a significant challenge, bike in Indonesia or in the Congo. We talk about in Indonesia about, now anyway, depends how you count it, how much peat is, being 15 or 25 million. You talk about 10 to 15% of the total land mass. Look, if you are a development planner and you've been asked to set aside 15% of your total land mass in your lowlands, which you know for, of course, then you create a significant challenge. And honestly, we have no other choice. If you don't set aside peatlands, if you don't conserve peatlands, the alternative is losing peatlands, which you ultimately make, sometimes you make jokes about that if you have some future foresight, if you want to have buy prime beach property, yeah, buy land in Palangkaraya and Pekanbaru, because those cities might be on the coast within 25, 30 years from now. Look, that's the challenge we are facing. And this means as well that we need to innovate. And I agree with lots of things that have been said here, but in particularly on the we need to look particularly at the employment side of things, because we have to create alternatives for the people who are living in these areas. Because we have to be clear, if you raise a water table, be it in the Netherlands, be it in Indonesia, be it in the Congo, you will reduce your suitability for many crops of your land, which means you have to develop alternative livelihood options. I think to me that's clear, which means that we have to invest in alternative development options for these areas.
Yeah.
And this means often meant by a wider lowland development approach, which I think probably is the way to go. But it will create, of course, significant impacts economically. And but yeah, and they said, I see, and since no way out, and the same, even in the Netherlands, if you look there, for example, at dairy farming, if you bring up the water table to surface, which is in the Netherlands minimum requirement if you want to stop any subsidence, then basically you have to stop producing cow cheese. That's reality.
Yeah.
And so I think so, and that I think we need to be creative, and that's why this international cooperation, particularly in the subject, is so important, because otherwise I think it will be difficult to see a significant progress in the future. And that means if that's not the case, then ultimately we end up in a place which is much hotter than it is now.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Pak Adam Jeram.
Firstly, thanks to all the speakers. I think they've covered a lot of points. In closing, I think I just want to reiterate a couple of things I've heard from everybody else, if I can. I think we've heard that the management of peatlands is very complex and challenging. It will take a lot of effort, it will take money, and it will take coordination between all of us and all of the agencies. Globally, they're small. Historically, they haven't been given much attention, with climate change particularly. There's been a realization that we need to do more because they are so prominent and important. So countries like Indonesia have an international responsibility, and I think also an international opportunity to prove some good practices here. And as Harry and several speakers have said, we've got trade-offs. There is competition between the different land uses. We've learnt a lot about how to do things. We've come a long way, especially in the past couple of years, on policies and on mapping and on technical knowledge of how to manage peatlands or how not to manage them. So we know how to do better from our negative policies and practices in the past. But we still have a long way to go, especially on developing the sustainable land use policies. The polluticulture is a nice concept, but we do not have very many practical working examples on large scale, so we need to do research on that. This is really important to give local people livelihoods so they know how to use this land in a sustainable way, but can still continue living there. They do not, in many cases, have other options of places to go, so they need some help. I think we need to also have better tools to help decision makers and land managers on the allocation of land at the sort of national licensing level. The moratoriums are good, but you know, then what do you do with this land? How do you allocate it for another land use? What are you going to do with it? This is a national kind of policy issue and a provincial government issue. There needs to be better tools and understanding of these things. It's at the moment we still have a bit of a vacuum, a big gap in those tools and what is the best practices on these different kinds of land. That's why I talked about land use or sustainability and the allocation process in my concluding slides. And I think we need to help the decision makers and right down to the local communities what their land management practices should be based on science and based on what we do know from good and bad practices in the past. I really encourage Indonesia to continue this work, the recent good work particularly, and to advance this work on peatlands, publish it, share the results with other countries, because you are really leading the way in many of these big challenging issues, and many countries are watching what you are doing, and with respect, and I think you have a good opportunity here. Acknowledging the past poor practices is one thing, but you cannot change history. You need to move on and go forward positively, and I'm really pleased about that. From the FAO side, we stand ready to help, and I wish you well with this really important work. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, the last one, Pak Heri.
Thank you. I would like to address the last question that speaks to me. I agree, we need options, collaboration, control. Option, yes. But to me, option is there. But who is going to try that option? Who is going to invest? Any option is whether sago, whether the celutung, whether pineapple, they need kind of investment. There's a lot of investment. So we need to figure out now who is going to invest. Also, the persistency of the who's going to try. This is option. If you do it, it's not necessary you will succeed at the first try. You need the second, third, fourth, fifth try. That's a lot of cost. Who bear the cost of this peatland restoration? I recall again the budget coming from the Ministry of Forestry is $5 per hectare per year. Only $5. Per hectare per year. It's not much. So you need to ask more money to the government in order to keep the forests being a forest. The second one is collaboration. Who is going to collaborate? It's also important. Are we going to ask the large corporation to collaborate to maintain the peatland? They have money. Or are we going to ask the government, the donors? It's important to understand if we collaborate, who actually bring the resources. It's whether the community to me is, they can share the human resources, but not much actually capital available there, particularly in terms of money there. And my last statement actually, we talk a lot about the peatland restoration. To me, good also to understand the contestation between the different actors, who to influence what happened on the ground, and try to influence those actors, try to influence the large corporation, try to influence community, try to influence government to make a better world. And again, I like to encourage the government to have a scoreboard of the CO2 emission to make sure that our emission today is better than 9 years ago. Otherwise, it's quite difficult to know whether we are in the right direction or we are even worse. I heard that the information is there, but not available to public. I don't know. But this is my encouraging. We need the scoreboard and feeling sense of successfully. Otherwise, it's criticized by a lot of people. Thank you for your time. Thank you.
Thank you. It's very interesting discussion among us. So I would like to summarize these sessions. Peatland management has a lot meaning for us in terms of biodiversity, climate change, livelihood. It is used us to have reasonability to protect and manage the peatland. Government cannot alone to manage the peatland, but there is a need contribution from other stakeholders. Indeed, peatland is very important natural resources. Proper peatland management is a top priority of the Indonesian government. The government has carried out long-term program on peatland rehabilitation. However, it is not sufficient. It should be supported by other parties or stakeholders, such as other sectors, local government, corporate, academicians, NGOs, researchers, and practitioners. In order to accelerate the target of peatland restoration, activities on the ground and policy intervention should be based on the scientific evidences. A mini destruction takes a decade to restore. The historic 2015 fire in Indonesia should be monumental as a world's archive. It could serve as a basis for developing technical, social, institutional approaches to forest land fire management. We hope we can learn a lot from this forum and sharing our experiences. I'm sure with strong commitment from all of us, we could make a better planet. I also trust that from this session we will bring home highly useful insights related to peatland management. By that, I would like to close this session. Please big applause to all of us. Thank you very much for all the speakers.